Yeah, so in this class, what we are going to do is that I'll give you a very brief introduction about finite element method and a few characteristics of FEM, its applications, possible errors that you can have while running an FEM simulation, etc. So FEM is basically a numerical technique, and that is used to obtain approximate solutions to complex problems. So have you heard about FEM before? FEM means finite element method. Have you heard about that before? Have you heard about a finite volume method or finite difference method, something like that? Or do you know what is a numerical method in general, a numerical technique used to solve partial differential equations? I guess you haven't heard. So okay, I'll just start anyway. So like I told, finite element method is a numerical technique that is used to obtain approximate solutions to complex problems. Complex problem means how complex can the problem be? So I'll just show you a few videos. Okay, it's a good idea to share the whole screen. What you're seeing here is basically a finite element simulation of a heart, a human heart. So this is the potential of the method. You can simulate almost any real life or engineering problem using finite element method. So if you need to study heart, its functions, its material properties, you don't need to, it's actually very difficult to get an actual heart. So different kinds of studies, like when the blockage in the veins in the heart happens, how can we get rid of the blockage, what do we do if there is a pressure difference, and there are a lot of questions that that is very relevant in medical science, which can be studied and analyzed using finite element method. This one is a crash simulation using finite element method. So do you know what is a crash test? A crash test is used to analyze how safe a car is. Car or in general any vehicle. So if you want to conduct a crash test, you need to destroy an actual car. If you want to conduct 10 crash tests, you need to destroy 10 cars. So you can actually simulate the whole crash using finite element method. So the first video is the actual real test, and the second one is the results using simulation. You can see that the simulation results matches very well with actual crash test. And there is no limit to what you can actually simulate. If you can model any real life or engineering problem using partial differential equations, you can indeed simulate it using finite element method. Here is a FEM simulation of a digital horse, actual animal. So what they have done is that they have actually simulated the entire animal, its bones, muscles, everything is described using mathematical functions, partial differential equations, and our technique, numerical technique called FEM, is used to simulate the whole process. Now the coming back to the question, so what is FEM? FEM is a numerical technique that is used to get the solutions. But what are the kind of problems that we can actually solve using FEM? Have you? I'm sure that you have. You already know some numerical techniques. Have you heard about Runge-Kutta method? I'm going to make sure that one of you answer my question. Have you heard about Runge-Kutta method? Raki says yes. And what is that? Can you turn on your mic and tell me what was it? You don't need to tell me what exactly it is. What can you remember about it? You learned it during your school days, I think, or maybe in the first year of engineering, I don't know. What was that? Can someone turn your mic on and tell me, or if you haven't heard about it, tell me that. Runge-Kutta method. Abhijit, are you there? Rahul, yeah. Have you heard about Runge-Kutta method? And what was that? Yeah. Okay. I'm glad that you tried. So, Runge-Kutta, can you see the graph here? Yeah. So, assume that you have a function, some function, y is equal to x squared, and or any function. Y is equal to f of x. So in Runge-Kutta method, what you do is that you have the function with you. So to plot it, what you do, you find the slope of the curve at any point, and using the curve, using the slope, you will find out next point, and then again you will evaluate the slope there, and then you will move forward to a small distance delta x again. And that's how you plot the whole function. So this is a technique used to approximately plot a function. So that is what a numerical method is. That is an example of a numerical method. So finite element method is basically a numerical method, but far, far, far more complicated than Runge-Kutta or any method you have studied before. So I'm not going to, I don't have the, you know, I don't have enough time to tell you what exactly FEM is. What I can do is that I can give you a very brief introduction and talk about some important features and characteristics, talk about some applications, and talk about where we can have, you know, where it is possible to get some errors, etc. That's the scope of the class. We can't do anything more than that. So you already know that you can solve very complicated problems using finite element method. So to apply finite element method, you need to convert any problem into a set of partial differential equations. Once you have a partial differential equation, for example, for the car I've shown you earlier, for the crash test, how will you use a mathematical formulation to describe a crash test? What equation can you use? It's a huge car, right? There is a car, there are a lot of components, engines, tires, there may be a human being inside, there will be air resistance, friction, there are a lot of components and a lot of different kinds of inputs. How do we actually use partial differential equations to represent the entire car? How do we do that? So the idea is that just like the name suggests, finite FEM is finite element method. We will divide huge structures, complicated shapes into finite elements, small, really small elements. And we will solve, and each small element can be described using a partial differential equation. And we will assemble such small elements to make the whole structure. And that process is called discretization. Let's say you have a simple beam. Okay, this is a beam connected to a wall. And what happens when you apply a force here? The beam deflects downward. So if the beam deflects downwards, can you use a single equation to describe the whole beam? Not actually. That's very difficult. So what we'll do is that we will cut the beam into different small elements. And we will use an appropriate partial differential equation in each of the element and combine it with boundary conditions. So what will be the boundary condition in this case? Boundary condition will be that it is fixed on the wall. If it is fixed on the wall, the part which is fixed on the wall cannot be moved. So deflection at that point will be zero. That is a boundary condition. And if you are applying force on the other end, there is another boundary condition. So this is a complex shape. Let's say, see this one. This is probably, I don't know, this is I think an engine component or something. Yeah, some component. What have they done here? This huge component cannot be described using one single equation. So they will cut the whole component into really, really small parts, and each of the small part will be described using partial differential equation, which can be modeled using FEM. See this one, or this one. So however complicated the geometry is we will make it simple by cutting it into very very small simple parts, and each of them will be solved using a computer, and all of them will be assembled together to get the solution. So that is the basic technique we use for finite element method. So I don't know whether you have really understood the, of course I could not really describe the theory behind FEM, but this is essentially the basic idea behind FEM. So these are the keywords. FEM is a numerical technique, and you get approximate solutions using FEM. You will not get exact solution. That's getting an exact solution is impossible. Why is it approximate? Because you are approximating the whole structure by cutting into several small parts, and each small part is being described by a simple equation, an equation that can be modeled numerically. So these are the key terms that you need to understand. So you usually have one differential equation or many differential equations along with some boundary conditions and initial conditions. A basic classification of types of problem that you encounter in FEM. There are actually three kinds of them: boundary value problem, initial value problem, and eigenvalue problem. These are again very common terms we use in mathematics. I'm sure you are familiar with them. What is a boundary value problem? What is an initial value problem? What is a boundary value problem? Can someone tell me? Have you heard about it before? I'm just making sure that some of you are here. Rashmi, are you there? Rashmi Devarma. Payal. I think if I ask you more questions, the remaining of you will also leave the class, so I better continue. Alright, so there are three types: boundary value problems, initial value problems, and eigenvalue problems. So boundary value problems, like the name indicates, if you have a partial differential equation and boundary value problem, boundary value is also prescribed, then you call it a boundary value problem. For example, in that case, in the beam I talked about 5 minutes ago, the beam has two ends. One end is fixed on the wall, and on the other end you are applying force. So these are two boundary conditions. Deflection is zero where the beam is attached to the wall, and there is a given force on the other end. So two boundary conditions are given, and hence it's a boundary value problem. Initial value problems are usually time dependent problems. Assume that you have a cricket ball with you, and you take the ball and you drop the ball from a height from 1 meter, let's say. You simply drop the ball. What happens to the ball? The ball goes down, it hit the floor, it comes up and again hit the floor, and it does some oscillation and it stops. So here there are some initial conditions. What are the initial conditions? So in the beginning, you leave the ball from a height, maybe with a certain initial velocity, or maybe with initial velocity zero, or maybe you are throwing it up. So depending on the initial condition you're giving, the result will be different. So if you throw the ball up, it will go up. So if you give a positive velocity, it will go up. If you give a negative velocity, it will go down. So the whole solution of the problem depends on the initial condition. So those type of problems are called initial value problems. So for complex problems, you can have both boundary values and initial values. Eigenvalue problems are a different category of problems where you calculate certain parameters called eigenvalue. You already know what eigenvalues are. So the eigenvalue may have some physical meaning. For example, if you are if you have a column, if you are compressing a column from either side, and column may have something called a mode shape. So that can be physically for such problems, eigenvalue can have certain physical significances. Again, I can't go into any more details. So you need to understand that there are three types of them. And to give you some examples of some simple problems that people usually solve when they start understanding finite element method. So a simple problem usually have a very simple geometry, uniform material, and simple boundary conditions. So first case is an example from mechanics of solid. You have a simple bar element and you are applying a force on the bar element. So if you apply a force, the bar, what will happen to the bar? The bar will extend a little bit. So you can use this partial differential equation to describe this bar. And what are the boundary condition? Like I told, bar is fixed on the wall, so displacement is zero there, and you are applying a force here. So this is another boundary condition. Heat transfer problems, that's another category of problems. You have a element through which heat conduction happens. Heat is being dissipated into atmosphere, and there is a certain value of temperature on the other end, and it may be insulated on one side. That depends on the problem. So you can describe the problem using one equation, a differential equation or a partial differential equation, and you can have initial conditions and boundary conditions. Another category of problem, very common category of problem, is fluid flow problems. You can have a fluid flowing through pipe, and the basic physics of the fluid flow can be used to come up with a PDE, means partial differential equation, and along with associated boundary condition, you have a simple problem. Again, in electromagnetics, you can have simple problems. So in all engineering departments, we mechanical engineers use it. It's very common here, and I'm sure in your department also, especially in civil engineering, electrical and electronics, almost everywhere this is FEM is commonly used. And those are very simple problems. And now, how does complexity arise? Complexity can arise due to difficult geometry and difficulty due to material modeling and difficulty due to boundary condition. I'll quickly describe these things. So geometry complexity. So in the slides I have shown earlier, geometries were very simple. Simple linear element. Fluid flow, again very simple. So here you can see that if the geometry gets complicated, the problem becomes difficult. Now, we using FEM, how do we solve this type of problems? like I told you, we cut it into small elements. That again we'll see later. I'll simply go through it. Difficulty due to material modeling, how can that arise? Just like the way geometry can get complicated, you can have multiple material also. You can have aluminium in the first half and copper in the second half. So those are two different materials which follow two different equations. Again, for heat transfer, if you have different material, you have different PDEs, or the partial differential equation may be the same, but the constants associated with the equation may be different. Again, it becomes complicated. For fluid flow, you can have multi-phase flow or two different types of fluid flowing together. In electromagnetics also, it can get a problem, can get complicated. Complexity can also arise due to boundary conditions. So a simple square will be, or in a linear element, you can have simple boundary conditions, like at one end you have one condition, on the other end you have one condition. So if it's a 2D case, it gets that gets complicated. You can have 2D case with certain edges, corners and different shapes, because of which problem become more complicated. So like I told you, the fundamental concept of FEM is that it splits up a complex problem into a greater number of simpler problems, which we call, that process is called discretization. And each of these simple element will be glued together to get the bigger complex structure or complex problem. So that's where the term element comes. Finite element method. FEM divides the domain of interest into finite number of simple subdomains. And we will use variational concepts to construct the approximate solution. Again, this is actually a very important term. I don't have enough time or scope to describe these things. The variational formulation, that's a very important word. We use variational formulation to discretize the partial differential equation. Just make sure that you remember this word, variational concepts or variational formulation. So each of these smaller little elements will be assembled together to get the complex problem. So element is another important term. So let's say this is your actual solution, right? This is a simple 1D problem, one dimensional problem. And in FEM, what do? We will split this domain into maybe three parts. But if we split into three parts, we can see that there are certain complicated physics here. Here the slope of the function changes very quickly. Here derivatives are changing quickly. So what we'll do is that we will divide that particular part into different sections again. So if there is no change in physics, the domain, the element can be bigger. If there are complicated physics or features, we will have to use smaller elements at those locations. And types of element. For a one-dimensional problem, obviously you need only 1D element. For 2D problems, 2D elements. So 1D elements is usually a line. Or a line means you can use a first order equation or a second order equation or a third order equation to describe a small element. Higher order elements are more efficient than lower order elements to describe the problem. So in 2D case, you can use triangles or rectangles or pentagonal elements, hexagonal elements. You can use whatever 2D elements you prefer to use, but you should be able to model the 2D elements using mathematical equations. In 3D, again, you can have all these different types of shapes to split the bigger complex domain into smaller domains. Again, so this is an important idea. So I'll just show you. Yeah, so these are linear elements. So first, in the case A, you are using linear elements. Here you are using quadratic elements. Here the order of the element is even higher. So higher the order of the element, more accurate will be your solution. So what does FEM do? These are the steps involved in FEM. So you have a physical problem, and like I told you, you will come up with a mathematical model. So a physical problem like a big car or a human heart, these are very complex physical systems. Those must be mathematically modeled. You must write a partial differential equation for such complex physical system. So that is the first step involved, coming up with an ideal mathematical model. So the question here is, will this mathematical model accurately describe the physical system? That depends on how accurate you want. It can be accurate enough for a lot of practical purpose, but never fully accurate. There will always be some errors involved in when you are converting, you are idealizing a physical system using a mathematical model. That's always true, right? If you have a projectile, you must have learned in engineering mechanics, if you have a projectile motion, you know that there are very simple equations to find out the horizontal range and final velocity, etc. But there are always complex inputs like air resistance, and there are different things we are trying to ignore. So here also, when you idealize a physical system using mathematical model, you are neglecting or you're failing to notice some aspect of the physical system. So there will be errors involved, but error should not be large enough to affect a practical purpose. That's the goal of the FEM, is to come up with an approximate solution to a physical problem that is useful to engineers and scientists. Okay, the final solution we come up with should be useful for some purpose. So errors are, when I say errors are usually small enough to be neglected for a practical purpose. So that is the first step. Now you don't have a physical problem. What you have is the set of mathematical equations. And these mathematical equations should be discretized. So what do we do here? We will discretize the domain. We will divide the domain into several smaller parts, and we will use we will come up with an algebraic system of equations, or in matrix formulation, you must have learned in your linear algebra sessions. This complex mathematical partial differential equation can be converted into something, a form called Ax equal to b, where A is a matrix, where x is a vector, unknown vector, and b is again a matrix on the right hand side. So that's that process is called discretization. And after that you have to find out the solution, and your matrix system, algebraic system of equations, will be very big, very complicated for a complex physical problem. So when you are trying to find out the solution of it, it's very difficult to get the actual solution. So there will be some errors involved there also. So there are errors in mathematical modeling, and when you discretize the problem, when you convert the mathematical equations to a system of algebraic equations, there will be some errors involved. They are called a discretization error. And then again, when you are finding out the solution, there is going to be an error. So there are error in each steps. So your final equation will your discrete model give you an equation like this. Ku is equal to, that's what I told, Ax equal to b, or Ku is equal to f, where K can be something called a stiffness matrix, or that depends on the problem. Right hand side can be force matrix or something else depending on the physical system. So K is usually a property, U is the behavior, solution we are looking for, and F is some sort of action. And again, I can't generalize it, that depends on the problem. So that property can be stiffness, conductivity, permeability, or dielectric permittivity. Again, depends on the kind of problem we are going to deal with. So the behavior, the solution we are looking for, can be displacement, can be temperature, head pressure, electric potential, etc. And the actions involved can be force in case of elasticity problems, heat source in case of thermal problems, you know, body force, charge, etc. So there are different methods for deriving an FEM equation. There is something called a direct method, a Galerkin method, Rayleigh-Ritz method. You just understand that there are different techniques used. I can't describe each of the techniques. So this is just an example here. Let's say you have a vertical milling machine. The milling machine has a very complex geometry, very complex boundary conditions and initial conditions. So first section step is that you use some governing equations and boundary conditions to approximate the problem, and then you will use FEM to approximate and come up with a set of simultaneous algebraic equations. So again, I've told you different, so many times now, divide the domain into small number of parts, and each field quantity is interpolated by a polynomial of an element. In each element you can use sometimes a linear element or a quadratic element, or some simple equations for each of the smaller element. And each of the element may be connected to other elements. So degrees of freedom of one element may be shared with the connecting element. So that should be accommodated in the total equation. So for each smaller element, there will be small equations, a set of algebraic equation, and all of them can be combined to get the big final equation, which is Ku is equal to F, and we'll find out U from there. And once k u is equal to f, what is the solution? U is equal to k inverse f. That you can write it very easily, but that process is not easy. Finding out solution is very difficult, and there may be small errors involved in the process. So what are the advantages of FEM? It can handle very complex geometries. It can handle wide variety of engineering problems. Can handle complex restraints. Can handle complex loadings. So I've already given you a few examples of complex FEM problems, like simulation of heart, brain, or full human body, or flight simulation. You can simulate an entire flight journey using FEM. Engine of a flight, or Earth, the whole Earth can be simulated using FEM. So these are all very different, very complex type of FEM problem. And climate modeling is another common complex example of FEM problem. So this is the era of climate change and climate action, and global warming. So climate modeling and simulation is a very popular research field these days. Another example of a complex FEM problem. So what are the disadvantages of FEM? FEM obtains only approximate solutions. I told you in the beginning itself, you get approximate solution, not exact solution. But that solution will be accurate enough for you to for some practical purpose. There should be benefit, some benefit from the solution. But however, there are going to be errors. We can analyze the errors, but errors will be there. And errors will be there in the each step of the FEM solving process. So these are the errors involved. There is a modeling error in the beginning. I told you before, modeling error. After that, there is a discretization error, and there is an error in finding out the solution. So this is you must remember these terms. You must remember the process. You must understand the whole process, and you must also understand that there is error involved in each of the step. And in case, if asked in exams, you must be able to write these things. FE applications. FEA means a finite element analysis. Same thing, FEM. Okay. So like I told, I've already given you a lot of examples so far. Mechanical, aerospace, civil, automotive engineering, structural analysis, stress analysis, fluid flow, heat transfer, electromagnetic field, soil mechanics, acoustics, biomechanics, and many other things. And there are several popular finite element software packages available now. These are very common, and some of them are free also. So you don't have to, if you want to solve a problem, you don't have to write a code for your own. A lot of packages are available. You can very easily get it from the internet. The commonly used free softwares are Deal2, Phoenix, FreeFM, Get FEM plus plus, etc. You can very easily download this from internet and start using. These are completely free, and there is no charges at all. There are some popular paid softwares also: Abacus, Adina, Cosmol Multiphysics, Nastran. These are all again FEM softwares, but not free, paid softwares. So just to summarize, FEM is a computational technique for the solution of differential and integral equations that arises in various fields of engineering and applied sciences. So FEM is useful for problems with complicated geometries, complicated boundary conditions and complicated material properties. So the main concept of the fundamental concept of FEM is that a given domain can be viewed as an assemblage of simple geometric shapes called finite elements, which will be used to come up with a system of algebraic equations which we solve using numerical methods. So yeah, that's it. So this is the final step of FEM. You will come up with an equation in the form k is equal to f, where u is the solution vector, k is a matrix that represents a property of the physical system, and f is some sort of action. So that's it. Any questions? Any questions? Yes or no? Any questions? No questions. Okay, then thank you. We'll conclude.